You wake up in the morning, have your coffee, turn on TV to hear what's in the papers, whether there's delays on the LIE. You got your day off started right, but now nighttime has come. You need your favorite duo from New York One, Pat and Jamie's New York. Pat and Jamie's New York, yeah, yeah. Pat and Jamie's New York. Pat and Jamie's New York, yeah, yeah. Ooh, I say it again. She's an Eagles fan and he's Canadian. Wow, Pat and Jamie's New York, yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Pat Kiernan and Jamie Stelter!
Leslie Goshko, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Leslie.
Thank you,
hi,
Leslie.
Guys.
We have an awesome show tonight. And it turned out to be such a pretty day.
It did, and it's Super Tuesday the 3rd.
It is.
Thank you for pulling yourselves away from CNN. Or New York One.
My husband, who works at CNN, said he'll give us election updates if we want them.
Jordan Roth is backstage, our first guest.
He is.
Thank you.
Yes. I met him at a dinner party and honestly like fell in love with him right away. He is just the warmest, sweetest human, him and his husband, Richie. And I love them dearly. And he has so much to say about living in New York.
Julie Klausner's backstage as well. She will be our second guest. She's between seasons of Difficult People for Hulu.
Yes.
And we appreciate that she fit us in between all of the preps for season two.
She also has a lot to say about living in New York.
She does. Can we talk about this DC thing to start?
Okay, so big breaking news this afternoon. I don't know if you heard, maybe you did. It depends if you follow my Twitter feed or not. But the DC Metro is going to completely shut down tomorrow for 24 hours.
I guess they can get away with, can you imagine here? If just on a random weekday with 12 hours notice, they said, no, that's it?
So there was
it?
Some kind of fire, and they said that they have to investigate all the electrical cables, and that's going to, and they need to do it, obviously, right away. But when I tweeted it, I got a lot of mixed responses, and I was actually surprised at how many people. Because I said at first, I don't want to see anyone's cranky subway tweets tomorrow. Because we have a subway.
Because it's better here than there.
Yeah. And there were people who said, we love the subway system. That would never happen here. We have the best subway system in the world. And other people who said, they should shut it down. They need to get, you know, they need to fix all the problems here.
Were the conspiracy theorists out? Because I could see that tweet coming immediately.
Well, of course, I think even I was going down that road because I said, if they're shutting down the whole thing tomorrow, and it has to be tomorrow,
maybe there's something more than safety.
And it was like electrical cables. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I know what you're saying. Did you see the bus of we talked about it on TV, but this bus of the future that they unveiled last week?
Yeah, which I think is going to be great. It has Wi-Fi and USB ports and all these fancy bells and whistles.
That's what I'm having trouble getting past, though, is the USB port thing. So,
don't you want to charge your phone on the bus?
No, I do want to charge my phone on the bus. So while the wheels on the bus are going around, and you're there trying to charge your phone, there's probably only three chargers on the whole bus.
Think there's going to be fights
over the
USB port?
No, there's going to be like a stabbing over, I had the USB port first.
You have no faith in New Yorkers. I actually think that is great because this should be the beginning of there being USB ports everywhere. I should be able to charge my phone at my table at every restaurant, on every subway car, every place I go. I should be able to quick plug in.
Or Apple should just be good enough to build a battery that lasts, say, most of the day.
There's that too.
Thank you.
Speaking of what we were talking about on TV,
yeah.
This is a really big week for you.
So it was this week in 1996 that I arrived in New York. And so we dug into the New York One archive.
And we found baby Pat Kiernan on TV. Which makes me really happy. Oh, I thought we're, oh, there it is. Look.
What? Yeah, I see that. I see that. It was Fortune Business Report, March 14th, 1996. The
Dow. People always say that you don't age, and I feel like looking at this, it's true. You don't.
Watch, watch in a second here. That we got the screen for the Dow Jones Industrial Average. It's at 55.68. I should have bought stocks then.
Look at you. I love that. 20 years ago, do you want to know where I was?
We do this like once a week where Jamie tells everyone in New York how much younger than me she is.
I was like about to have my first boyfriend in ninth grade. I was learning like algebra, maybe.
I was only 15 there. we moved here for a few years. Like you think, oh, I'll, you know, I'm going to take the job off in the city. Well, that'll be fun for a few years.
Right, and then we'll figure
it out.
And then
one thing leads to another, and here I am. It's been 19 years since I first started getting up at 3 a.m. to be morning anchor in New York One.
Unbelievable. That deserves an applause.
Thank you. Yes. This is the commitment I have to keeping New York informed. So I have to confess about something.
Oh.
It was, what was the last awards that we did? Was it Oscars?
Was yeah.
Yeah, so there was a Cars for Kids commercial.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. No. Please,
I know, it'll
no,
like drive
please,
me
please,
insane.
Please don't put it in people's heads. So during the telecast, the Cars for Kids commercial came on.
Right.
And I've only heard it on the radio. I've heard it a billion times on the radio, and we actually have a family policy where whoever can reach for the radio fastest mutes it.
To turn it off.
So that you don't hear the evil, catchy Cars for Kids commercial. So I tweeted that I didn't know they had a TV version of this.
So we watch different feeds in the morning, which I don't know if that's hard to explain or not, but I see and hear the Cars for Kids commercial. Yeah. 17 times every morning.
See, I see a blank screen when we're in commercials.
I see that, and I see the Roscoe, the bed bugs dog.
So I tweeted that I didn't know there was a Cars for Kids commercial, and all of New York tweets back, "You don't watch your own channel ever."
20 years, that's how I survived, not watching a minute of it.
You were complaining about lunch the other day.
I
think I started it.
You were complaining about lunch first.
Because it gets expensive.
Right, so because you tried the new thing from Hale and Hearty.
Right, they have these they call them simmers. There's some noodles and then something on top of them. It's not quite a soup, it's not quite a...
Like maybe not quite food.
No, it's tasty. The Thai peanut chicken thing is really good.
So there's a Hale and Hearty inside Chelsea Market, so it's always an easy...
It's like $12 for lunch.
Yeah,
I'm just looking for a fast lunch.
So,
it's $3.99 to go to Subway.
So I usually bring my lunch every day for a lot of reasons. I want to be healthy. I like to eat at like 10 in the morning, a big dinner size portion of something, and nothing's open yet.
No, it's hard to get anything but an egg sandwich at 9 a.m.
Yeah. So I didn't bring my lunch the other day, and I was in trouble, and I thought... Oh, Pat had one of those things.
Simmers from Hale and Hearty.
So maybe I'll go try that. So I walk into Hale and Hearty, and I kind of like gave it a glance and was like, that's not gonna happen. So then I was like, sort of like the worst thing is to be walking around Chelsea Market half aimlessly and hungry, because it's crowded and it, like you get annoyed really fast. So, and it wound up being really bad. I wound up getting tacos and then I was still hungry and I got a milkshake and you wind up just like, I wound up spending like double the amount of a Hale and Hearty, whatever it is.
Simmer.
But it's true because we order in or go out to dinner all the time. We spend lots of money on that, more than we should.
Mm-hmm.
But for lunch, for some reason,
feels
fuel. Ridiculous.
Lunch is just fuel, just getting you to the next stage.
I don't want to buy a $17 salad that keeps me full for 12 minutes. We need better lunch options.
Okay.
Thank you.
Every time we do this show, we pick a topic that New Yorkers can relate to. So this week, Our topic is New York fears.
Yeah, so it spurred from a tweet that I saw, and I thought, gosh, people have lots of crazy things that they're scared of, things that I hadn't thought of, that I was like, oh man, maybe I should be scared of more things.
And we went out on the street and we were asking fellow New Yorkers about this, and the first few people we asked, apparently we asked the question the wrong way, because they all went, I'm really scared of terrorism, and then it got to be not at all a fun conversation. Because we had in our heads that they're going to say, drips from air conditioners.
Yeah.
Or you know, got in a cab and forgot my wallet.
Should we say what ours are?
Let's run the video and then do that. Here are some of the worst fears of New York.
Right. All right, so our topic today is, what's the New Yorker's greatest fear? Like, is it getting stuck on that subway, or?
Lately, crane collapses.
Oh.
Isn't that scary to walk
around?
There
was just one on the news.
I know, in Tribeca.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, but do you actively look up and go, can I just...
You actively look up and you cross to the other side of the sidewalk.
What's your big New York City fear?
My biggest fear is being late for lunch. Working in the corporate world, you have all these meetings that you have to attend.
Okay.
6 minutes late for mine.
Go then.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Well, I'm not really that scared, but I think the number one thing would be the New York City rats.
Good one.
Yeah, we really have to do some control on that.
Are
also,
are you scared that the rats will come up and
I'm scared that they're gonna get bigger. I'm scared that these rats are gonna just start growing to a point where they may be the size that we are. I'm scared of that.
You got a second to talk to us?
Come on over.
We're asking people what their worst New York fear is, like getting stuck in an elevator or
having a crane collapse.
My worst New York fear is that de Blasio gets reelected. That's my worst New York fear.
You're not scared of anything here in New York City?
Why would you? If you're gonna die, you're gonna die. It doesn't matter where you are.
I love that attitude. So you're not scared of scaffolding falling on you or an air conditioner falling on you?
Nothing. No, I've never had an air conditioner falling on me.
How about, do you take the subway? Are you scared of anything on the subway?
No.
Okay, we've heard people that are scared of getting stuck in elevators. Are you scared of getting stuck in an elevator?
No, police will come.
You are Superwoman, aren't you?
Not at all. I just live here. You must live somewhere else.
No, I live here, but I'm scared of some things here in the city. Yeah.
No, you shouldn't be. You'll die first anywhere else.
Well, thank you for your time.
Okay.
Not scared of anything.
There's nothing you could do to faze her.
I thought I could get her to confess something that scared her.
Nothing. Okay, nothing. So what's your thing?
So I think my biggest New York City fear is falling into the subway platform. The subway,
you mean
the
street,
the
sidewalk, right?
No. When you're down waiting for the subway,
oh, you're
going to
fall onto the tracks.
So not...
Are you tall enough to climb back up if that gets...
No, that's what I'm scared of. So I think that I'm not scared that someone is like maliciously gonna do something. I'm not scared of like an attack. I'm more scared that someone is just gonna mindlessly like bump. Do you know what I mean?
And I do a little of this with the pillar. I like to have my back to the pillar when I'm
waiting
for a
long
time.
Yeah, well, I do that. But sometimes it gets really crowded. There's lots of action. Everyone's walking really fast and they're doing all sorts of things. And I just feel like that could easily happen. And I don't know. I mean, I guess I would just like scream for someone to hopefully pull me up. Mm-hmm. That would be the benefit of being small, is that they could hopefully like hoist me out of there.
I have a subway fear too. And that's the, you hear the train coming and you decide that you're gonna do the stairs three at a time to get down and make the train. And every time I do it, I know, like, how stupid is this? There's another train in 4 minutes.
But you can't. No, but you gotta get to where you're
going. No, you can't help yourself. Like, you know, and I can tell at the Bedford Avenue station, I can tell whether it's the Manhattan-bound train or the Brooklyn-bound train by the sound, so I know when to sprint and when not to sprint.
By the sound?
Yeah, because the approaching train through the long tube sounds different than the train that's coming through the...
You're right,
thank you, right? You know what it sounds like. There's a difference. You can tell which direction the train's coming from.
I guess I don't take the subway that often.
Well, there is that. You live really close to the office.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you're scared of falling down the steps.
I'm scared of...
That's not like a New York City fear. That's like a...
No, I'm not scared of stairs in general. I'm scared of this self-imposed rapid stair descending that I put upon myself.
Yeah. But it is the worst feeling when you get downstairs and the door is just closed.
Not as bad as falling down the stairs.
Well, has it happened yet?
No.
I guess that's the whole thing about fears, is that, like, it's never happened before.
If it happened, that'd be the last time you did it. And that
like the rats that are as big as a person.
Yeah.
That would scare me.
That we'll find out from each of our guests what their fears are as well tonight.
I know. Jordan gave me a little clue about his, and I actually have a similar fear.
Okay. Don't steal his thunder. But let's bring him out here to talk about it. Our first guest is Jordan Roth, who knows everything about there is everything to know about Broadway you could possibly know.
Like he is the man to know in the Broadway world, and he knows everyone there is to know in the Broadway world. So he is the president of a company called
Jujamcyn.
I want to make sure I said it right. And so they have 5 theaters. I want to make sure I get the shows right. Book of Mormon, Jersey Boys, Kinky Boots, Rotten, and The Crucible, and Falsetto is coming back in the fall. He is a busy, busy man.
He's also made himself into a Periscope celebrity.
Yeah, he has a show called Making Mondays on Monday, like where it's a bunch of creative friends of his from the business, and they all get together and do fun things.
And friend of Jamie Stelter.
That's right.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jordan Roth.
That can be my entrance music for the rest of my life.
So what I also didn't know, which we should say right off the bat, that I did not know until I was like Google stalking you earlier today, is that you won a Tony Award. Hello! And you gave a beautiful acceptance speech. I watched
Thank
that
you.
Too.
It's all kinds of fun stuff on the Google.
There is a lot of fun stuff on the Google.
Do you have anything inaccurate on the Google you'd like to correct?
Probably.
Okay, actually, let me rephrase the question. How often do you check your Google to see?
No.
Never?
No.
That's a bad idea.
Do you have a Google alert on your name?
I do.
Okay, yeah, I have that too.
But it doesn't actually...
It sends weird stuff.
Yeah. Okay, I think I can say this. Richie, can I say this now?
Uh-oh.
My husband is out there. So we're having a baby, and... That's not the news. That news was announced. But
follow him on Instagram. You'll get all the news.
We have been shopping because that's now the most exciting weekend activity is like Giggle and Bye Bye Baby and back to Giggle and more Bye Bye Baby. But we're just registering Jews. You get it. And a friend came to us and said, oh my God, is it true? And we're like, what, is what true? So we registered at Bye Bye Baby and it went into the knot or one of those, the bump or one of those baby sites. And it came up on the Google alert that she had on me. So she found out we were having a baby from Google.
Oh my gosh, before you announced it on Instagram.
Yes.
Which
thankfully, not many people have a Google alert on me because everybody would know.
What have you purchased so far at Bye Bye?
Well, so we haven't purchased anything because it's superstitious.
Okay.
But
wait, so you can make a
itemized
list.
Yes. Yeah, you do.
I literally stay up till 1 a.m. watching videos of people reviewing their strollers.
I love it.
Which stroller is popular now? Because I have a beef with this. When my kids are now 11 and 14, all you did is you went out.
A lot's changed since then.
A lot. Here we go, the Pat is old theme again. All you did is you went out and you bought the McLaren, the foldable, city-friendly McLaren stroller. That was it.
Yes,
you're
that's
done.
Not what you do anymore.
Will you buy one of those?
You need like a Rolls
yes.
Royce.
One of those SUV-sized ones where everybody's got to get out of the
yes.
way on the sidewalk?
We are Range Rover baby carriages.
Fully support that.
Fully support.
But it's not, yeah, you don't have it yet. You will take delivery of the Range Rover.
I have it right. Up here. But no, we will, the Range Rover will be driven into the, wherever we drive the baby carriage to.
Oh, there's the whole New York City apartment thing of where do you park the damn thing?
I already have a spot.
Okay. does it involve space that your neighbors would take offense to, or it's in your...
No, that's so rude.
In the hallway.
No, we can't park the carriage in the hallway. That's so mean.
So you're scared of big people with big strollers. Let's talk about your New York City fears.
So I dug deep for this one. And I need to talk about SantaCon.
We have like my parents and my mother-in-law, maybe some other people who aren't from New York. So let's briefly SantaCon.
Friends who are not from New York. SantaCon is a Saturday in December where the city is besieged by people in all manner of Santa and elf outfits. And it's like the bar crawl to end all bar crawls. So literally we're talking tens of thousands of really drunk people starting at like 10 in the morning. And truthfully, my fear, I can broaden it.
Is this an annoyance or a fear?
No.
Well, he's getting there.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it actually, I would say, is both fear and dislike, annoyance, sometimes disdain. But the fear part is really any group of loud, drunk people on the street make me afraid.
Yeah.
You and me.
You have people agreeing with you.
And then, so now if they're in a Santa outfit, that just sort of ratchets it up.
It's taking the finest imagery of the season and bringing it down here.
Well, I'm very high-low.
And then how do you explaining the drunk Santa to the kids?
Yeah, no.
It also goes along
with... That's why you need the Range Rover carriage, so there will be no seeing of the drunk Santas.
That's a good point. That's like, I'm happy that I'm gonna be out of town tomorrow because it's the St. Patrick's Day parade. Nothing against anybody who's Irish, but like that brings out a whole other
type
of drunk
people. Didn't even think to be afraid of that, and now.
Spreading the fears.
So, good cheer to all.
On In the Papers this morning, as I'm live on TV, I realized that the entire St. Patrick's Day insert in the Post wasn't, you know, who's in the parade or whatever, it was ads for bars. For before and after.
Yeah, well, let's get to it.
Oh, that's smart advertising.
No, it's smart business sense.
And interestingly, the before. So, you know, like 9 a.m. drinks?
Gotta get started early.
Do it, man.
What's your thing about city bikes?
Oh, yeah, you have beef with this, too.
Okay. So my thing with the city bike, I fully support, like, I love great biking. My husband bikes, terrific, love it, great.
But
my issue is the like miles of them that you then can't get into the buildings from the street.
Yeah.
Right? So when they first came out, there were like people would wake up and walk out of their apartment building and not be able to get to the street till you had to like go a block out of the way to come. I'm feeling like people are not with me.
No, we're with you.
You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
It just seems like there are other annoyances, maybe, with city bike.
Go ahead. Listen.
I want to hear this one play out.
Well, I just feel like great with the city bike, but can we have small chunks?
Oh.
We need to have like the
block long, yeah.
Hang on. So would it be more stations, or just a break in each station, so there was a pedestrian passage?
That would be
nice. A pedestrian passage.
I feel like
because you can't squeeze through the handlebar.
Right.
And what there might be a bike missing. Then you could just walk through there.
Okay.
You can't fit in with your SUV stroller.
You're really gonna have a thing about this, aren't you? I swear, this is a bad memory, but I was late for a meeting. I was sprinting through like Times Square, and that's a whole another discussion. And we were getting. I kind of had this, I've got my rhythm, I'm going, I'm just gonna sort of turn this way to slide through the city bike. That was, we'll say, a mistake. If there were a pedestrian break, we wouldn't have this problem.
That's true. And it's funny, most people I think have a problem with either city bikers aren't wearing helmets or they bike the wrong way down the street and...
Yeah, no, it's totally dangerous.
Yeah.
I mean, sorry.
Oh, over just blanket statement?
For those reasons. No helmets, people who are not used to biking in the city, which is let's say, treacherous.
Yeah.
People who, you know, it's like not just the people who are taking it up and down the river, that's lovely. The people who are like dodging and weaving.
In and out of traffic.
In and out of Sixth Avenue.
My husband doesn't, I get really nervous about
it. Ryan, don't do that.
He does, I don't like that.
So take us into the Monday Periscope show.
Yes.
How did that start? And first of all, tell everybody how you can follow it, because anybody can watch.
Anybody can watch. So if you're on Periscope, you can watch it on Periscope if you follow me. You can also watch it on Twitter, so you don't have to get Periscope. You can just watch it right in the feed. Again, if you're following me, @Jordan_Roth.
He's such a fun person to follow. I'll talk more about that in a minute.
What we're doing, we're sort of reviving the Artist Salon 2.0. So we have a group of actors and writers and musicians and visual artists and chefs and news personalities, Stelters were special guests. And we come together in a room, and the idea is the best dinner party you've ever been to after. So if all of these creative people are at a dinner party, what happens after? And we create together. We write a play in the room that is read at the end of the show. We create songs together. We have choreographers that make dance pieces together.
And are you just walking around with the phone? Are you the cinematographer?
And I am walking around with the phone. And so our viewers get to create with us.
Yeah.
So that's the 2.0 part. So we, with each of the things that we're making, we're creating an opportunity for our viewers to co-create with us, to inspire it, to catalyze it. And it's really fun.
It's so much fun. So I went, and basically if you picture a room and there's like small groups of people throughout the room, mm-hmm. and one guy is writing a play that they're gonna perform at the end of the night, another group of people are choreographing this like big fancy dance that they're gonna perform at the end of the night. I was baking cookies in the kitchen.
As you do.
Jordan's walking around showing everyone on Periscope what each person's doing. And it's cool, it's like, I thought it was cool because what you don't realize is when you go see a Broadway show, as an audience member, I only think about the performance. Yeah. And you don't think about what all these creative people are doing every other day to sort of like keep their craft up to par of what they're doing, I guess.
Yeah. Creativity, you gotta prime that pump. And so kind of coming together and making, let's make live, go, mm-hmm. go, create, find something, invigorate. That's what it's about.
Let's say if you were at a dinner party where Periscope was all of a sudden live, is that a welcome? Are you off the clock at a dinner party?
SantaCon.
All right. I guess everybody knows what they're getting into, right? They know that there's going to be this on-the-record moment.
Well, yeah. That's the funny thing about it is, you know, you forget that we're live in a good way. Not in a, oh my God, I can't believe I said that way, but in a, let's just be in a room and make something and see what emerges from the group of people who are together.
Mm-hmm. Best thing that's happened so far on a Making Monday Periscope cast.
Besides my cookies.
The cookies were very good. Best thing that happened for me was the birth of a songwriter. So this amazing woman, Ariana, who is one of the dancers in Hamilton. If you've seen, she has this fabulous swath of hair clipped up. She's that dancer. And she came to us and sort of somewhere in the middle of the evening, I was over here filming one thing and I heard some music over there. So I finished with here, went over there, and Ariana and Josh Henry, who is soon to open in Shuffle Along, actually preview starting tonight. Right? They were singing with Robbie Roth, who is my partner in creating Making Mondays.
Not related.
And I went and filmed this amazing song, and then afterwards they told me that Ariana had remembered that she had written a poem on the subway on her phone about an exchange she had had with a guy that was upsetting. And she remembered it, and she said to Josh, I have this thing and I think maybe we can make something out of it. And he said, yeah, let's write music to it. And so a song was created, And she became a songwriter live in front of our eyes. And she came back a couple weeks later with a new song that she had written.
Wow.
And
that's beautiful.
It's really about kind of expanding the boundaries of creativity and who gets to be creative and how.
Can you just give it to Jordan for later? You don't have to read it.
I think the answer's probably no.
Can you get me Hamilton tickets?
Is this show a problem for the rest of Broadway? That people are like, I'm only gonna go to that. I'm gonna save up my entire Broadway budget so I can pay a scalper $900 to go to Hamilton.
Well, you really shouldn't be paying $900 to a scalper, but any of these shows, so you know, every couple of years a mega show happens, Book of Mormon, Lion King, Wicked, Rent. And any of these shows that gets the whole world talking about Broadway is good for Broadway and all of Broadway. So yeah.
I agree.
Good.
Do we have time for one more thing?
Two more if you can get me Hamilton.
So what you have to do is...
$900.
I reread this morning, which I had read after I first met you, your New York Times vows column with your beautiful husband, Richie, and everyone should Google that and read that if you're gonna Google and read anything about Jordan. It's the most beautiful thing. And I was rereading it, and because I remembered that it like made me emotional. And,
me too.
But what I love about it, something that we picked out of it was Richie says that you believe you can get anywhere in New York City in 15 minutes.
I believe that.
So does that mean that...
I behave as if that is true.
But you were super punctual tonight. Does it usually make you late for things?
Yes.
Yeah.
City bike, it would take 15 minutes.
Full circle. Yeah, so here's like sometimes it's from the West Village where we live to the 92nd Street Y. There's a lot of potential challenge
hazards
between here and there, Santas or not. And so we left ample time, but we made really good time.
Yeah.
I left at 7. It could have gone either way.
I know. There was no traffic today coming up here.
Yeah, that doesn't usually happen.
No.
But it's like 15 minutes.
It's not. It's more than that. Richie said, "Is it? It's 30." Listen to Richie.
I just love that was in your vows column.
Telling the truth.
Jordan Roth, thank you for being here. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
We'll work on that. Okay.
Hi, everybody.
I actually got to Hamilton early on, but I haven't taken my kids yet, and I feel like it's a good, good buzzy educational thing for them.
It is.
Yeah. Our second guest tonight has built kind of an empire now with her relatively new television program around New York and the quirks and the ups and downs in the city.
She is, it almost feels like Jerry and Elaine from Seinfeld, the way that her and Billy Eichner interact on Difficult People. It's on Hulu, by the way. Because they notice all the intricacies of the way people act now.
And I think we as New Yorkers can have a greater appreciation for the show than everybody else can have. I love, there was one of the first season episodes, they decided that they were gonna take the classics from the children's menu of restaurants, and they were gonna fancy them up.
Right.
So it was gonna be an adult restaurant, but with all things like fancy grilled cheese sandwich, fancy chicken fingers, and of course the New Yorkers completely misunderstood it and just brought their kids for overpriced meals.
And there's a lot of stuff about social media, like she's always tweeting on the show, which I love, because I think a lot of shows, they leave it out because it's hard to figure out how to incorporate it in, but they do a great job of getting all that in.
She is busy pulling together season 2. We're glad she has time for us tonight. Julie Klausner, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah. Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Pat, you're on the first episode of season two.
Oh, because we shot a scene for it.
Yeah.
I was excited about that.
It's the premiere. But you guys can all look forward to seeing Pat Kiernan playing the role of Pat Kiernan.
It's actually his favorite role to play.
No, all
he's
these,
very good at.
All these cameos that I do,
yeah.
I never leave the office, and yeah. I never interact with anyone from the cast. Everybody's like, how was it working with Julia Roberts? No idea.
Were you in something with Julia Roberts?
No, we just, I don't know.
Oh, was it that insane looking Gary Marshall movie where she's wearing that $20 wig? Like Mother's Day, is that
no.
it?
No, okay. No, I think I'm allowed to talk about this, and now the cat's kind of, there's a movie coming out in the spring called Money Monster, where George Clooney's kind of a Jim Cramer sort of CNBC type character.
Okay.
So you're in a George Clooney Julia Roberts
movie. Yeah. I am.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, hubba friggin' hubba, Mr. Kiernan.
We're not here to talk about me, Julie.
We're not?
No.
You asked me to prepare 40 bullet points about your charisma alone.
Jamie, you take over.
Let's talk about your New York City fears, because I think that a lot of people will relate. Jordan actually touched on one of them.
SantaCon?
Well, when he was talking about Times Square.
Oh, right, right. Yeah, no, my only fear in Times Square is that, someone will talk to me.
Like Elmo or a tourist or anyone?
Yes.
Anyone?
Yeah, anyone. I mean, whenever I see that I have something in Times Square, a feeling of dread overwhelms me.
So what do you do? You just avoid all eye contact?
You can't. Oh, well, completely. I mean, in general, yeah. But yeah, that's like my number one New York fear is that somebody starts talking to me and I can't get out of it. But that's my number one fear in general.
Like they'll recognize you from TV
and talk to you, or they just
realize that here's a New Yorker who knows more about this than I do.
Or it's just, or like, do you have a minute for Greenpeace? Or, you know, like, wow.
Oh, whenever you see a clipboard, it's like run.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Are you capable? Yeah. I'm gonna ask this to both of you. Are you capable of walking by a tourist who's puzzled over their map?
Capable of? I invented it.
Yeah. Oh, see, I have to stop. I always have to stop.
Oh, your Canadianness comes out sometimes, and it's so charming.
It only takes like 30 seconds. You're like, can I help you with something?
Can I help you? No, if they ask you, then you can answer.
Wow.
But no, if they're standing there completely bewildered, you just walk by.
Yes.
I don't even see them.
You really stop and ask people, can I help you?
At 14th Street all the time. They're trying to figure out the MetroCard machine.
Who's got time?
I'll walk past the block and I'll tell you every dog that was on the block. And, yeah. And honestly, they'll be like, did you see this murderer? And I'm like, I don't know, I saw a border collie.
I won't be happy until I learn every dog's name, age, and background story who lives in my building.
Yeah, what's the backstory for Curtis? What's Curtis's backstory?
Exactly.
Did we get to your New York fears?
Well, Times Square is one of them.
Being spoken to by strangers. lately slashings. I feel like slashings are like the new
hot
New York trend.
Wait, are all slashing. The people clapping scared of being slashed?
No, they're clapping
for. Oh my gosh.
They like slashing. That's why
we've made this up. I think this
is. Every day there's a new story about slashing, and I feel like slashing is like the new Cronuts or something. It's very trendy. It's very hip. All the kids are doing it, you know? Because it's like, they can't have guns. So what do they have? They have cool switchblades from the 50s, I think. I don't know. But I don't like the idea of getting slashed in the face.
I think if you did the Freedom of Information request, if you pulled the slashing numbers, it would be about the same. It's just that we're reporting it more.
Are you trying to debunk slashing?
No, I just think the media is to blame.
Got it.
Media is always to blame.
It's a good thing we're not on stage with any of the members of the media.
Not married to any, don't work with any.
but yeah, I think that's. Well, I mean, the air conditioner thing is gross for sure.
Yeah.
I used to find it so annoying when like street harassment, you know. But now that I have earbuds, it's like I don't care.
Yeah. You can hoot and holler all you want.
You bet.
You hate brunch lines.
Oh, yes, yes. I'm just scared of brunch in general. Whenever someone's like, do you want to go to brunch? I get really nervous.
Because the answer is no.
I just think there's going to be a line, and so I just never do it.
But I don't like brunch for a lot of reasons, but that's like maybe a whole.
That's thing. The number one, is like you're going to go somewhere, and then you see a bunch of people on the sidewalk, and you're like, I've made a terrible mistake.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, critical question. Mm-hmm. Can a New Yorker be someone born outside of New York?
Oh, completely. Absolutely. That's
no,
like...
I know, we both are.
Oh, no question. I think it's like, I think that it's sort of a parallel to like, can an immigrant be an American? And like, absolutely. It doesn't even matter how long you've been here. People that like, have what's the past tense for seek? A person who seeks out New York, who have sought New
out.
York, yeah. is someone that really wants to be here and is acclimated and is passionate, and like I think that's the very definition of a New Yorker.
Donald Trump was just saying that same thing about the immigrants the other
day. Well, he and I have so much in common. So.
Should we find out if he's winning anything right now?
I don't know. Is anybody on?
Can we just go for an hour and a half not thinking about it?
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I'm sure he is.
Carry on.
It's an ugly state of affairs.
There was a one of your Difficult People episodes. There was a YouTube star named Sissy.
Yeah.
And you were kind of jealous of Sissy because Sissy had 5 million views, and your character was struggling to not have. And Sissy actually had the nerve to tell you what you were doing wrong.
Yes.
I feel I feel like I don't know what it is. What's the secret sauce with the kids and their 5 million followers?
The kids.
They grew up with it. It's like growing up speaking a language. Of course you're better at it. You've heard it since you were, you know, forming. But yeah, that was an episode where...
But Julie, it's not right.
I couldn't agree more, Pat. I could come up with... I think most things are unfair. But yeah, the idea was that I'd babysat this kid, and she was a YouTube star. And it was very irritating to me. But yeah, and also YouTube is so antiquated. It's like Vine and Snapchat stars and, you know, Instagram stars. There's a whole generation of these kids today, Pat. I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah, Jamie's been experimenting with Snapchat.
How's that going, Jamie? Yep. You meet any friends? Yep.
It's fun. It's really fun in the beginning when you're playing with all the fun filters and things, and you can make like animated things coming out of your mouth and your ears and your nose and all that stuff. But I haven't quite
the bloom got, is off the rose.
Yeah.
Got it.
Haven't quite gotten the hang of it.
Not your medium.
No. Mm-hmm.
Jill, you have all these things going, your comedy, the books you've written, and then you sell the pilot for this show, and you make the show,
yes.
and they're kind enough to invite you back for a second season
yes,
of the show.
Yes.
Do you have any time where you're not now fully engaged in a creative process? Like how do you step away and just not think for a few minutes?
I do get a lot of pleasure making things, so it is, you know, not as stressful as just being busy, like running errands. But I will say that, I mean, I don't know, like I talk to friends a lot, and we did get a adult coloring book for the show as like a gag, like to make fun of it, you know? Like the bit was that like, it was an adult coloring book, but that depicted like actual adult situations, like considering an affair and herniated discs. You had to like color them, you know? And so our prop department made these like great mock-ups of adult coloring books. Like there's like a guy recycling. It's funny. So anyway, so at the end of the shoot, they were like, what do we do with these props? And I'm like, can I take one? And I brought it to my trailer with like some markers as like a goof. And now I'm completely, I've caught the adult coloring book fever, and I'm so embarrassed because it'd be like something I'd make fun of, but I really am extremely good at it. And
what's your highest number of hours in a sitting?
Oh, I never even counted because that's the thing when you're like making art, man. Like you get into the flow and then
does Billy color with you?
No, but that would be so cute.
It would be.
The two of us on the floor with our legs in the air.
What is it like working with him?
I have braces, he has headgear. Oh, it's a nightmare, Jamie. Every day is like, oh, no.
How much of him in real life is like what we know from watching
it. Because you change your last names on the show, right?
But yes, so we could do things that are outrageous and horrible, and it won't be like me doing them.
Is it 50% the same?
It depends. It depends. It goes really from like scene to scene and situation to situation. Are you saying how different is Billy from Billy on the Street or on Difficult People? Because he's very different from Billy on the Street. Yes, definitely. And the Billy on our show is a lot closer to who he is.
Oh, that's good to know.
But I've known him for long enough, and I've written for him long enough to sort of like find that balance and show stuff that I think is you can't show on Billy on the Street, and it's fun. It's nice to write for someone that you know well.
Yeah.
And how rooted in New York is the show?
So rooted in New York. That's what I love. First of all, the idea that we're like I want to say that the 92nd Street wide New York One partnership of brands is just fantastic. Like this is the most. I mean, like, just like the people in this room alone, like, if you, I mean, you just say the word Lender's Bagels and you'll hear like, ugh, you know, like there's just so much insider New York in this room and it's palpable and I love it. But yeah, there's a lot of stuff that's super insidery. You know, like, we just have these, like, we had an episode with SantaCon in it, you know, like we have these like references to these sort of stories that I think everyone knows about, and I find out that they're really small stories. But yeah, it's very New York-y, and it's very Jewish, and I'm always so flattered by any like Seinfeld or Curb Your Enthusiasm because those were Jewishest shows.
One of my favorite ones was when you guys went to was it an Oscars party?
Oh, the HBO premiere that we were kicked out of.
And at someone's apartment.
Oh, the comedy party. Oh no, the Oscar party and the pilot. Yes, I know what you mean. Yep. Mm-hmm.
And so you went over to someone's apartment, and it was.
I don't think Billy was not invited, right?
Correct. Yeah. Yes, I just
he wasn't
him
invited,
anyway.
But she brought him anyway. Yeah. And then Billy brought more people with him.
Yeah.
And then there was something about it when it was all this random mix of people in the apartment. Yeah. And I was like, that's so New York. And everyone
in like a crappy apartment and they're watching TV and they're like,
and there's like
this person sitting next to
me. And I know because like I'm always on Twitter or Instagram or something and you were on Twitter that night and it was like, there's always someone who like doesn't get it and who's rolling their eyes or like, why do you take it so seriously? And
I was like, that was from the pilot, and we were still figuring out the world, which is why Billy has other friends besides me.
Right.
We've quickly solved
got
that.
Rid of that.
We're each other's only friends now.
On the topic of difficult people, we thought it would be good to have some fun with this theme. So we have a little game for you. It is called Who's More Difficult?
Oh.
I think we have a theme song for it. Is it you or me? Is it he or she? Is it them or us? Who's a pain in the butt? Who's more difficult? Woo-hoo!
So the premise is a simple one. We're going to show you two people, and you can tell us who's more difficult.
Who seems like a bigger nightmare.
Yeah, and you can choose to elaborate or just let it stand on its own.
Okay.
So we thought we would start with a really easy one.
Okay.
Here we go.
Ah!
Pat or Jamie?
I have to say, I don't even want to play the game. I just want to know the context that these photos were taken.
Well, that was the topless women in Times Square story. And there is there's a director's cut of that that's never been released.
And Jamie?
I was showing off my hair do that.
Your top knot?
Top knot.
I think you guys are both. Roger Clark is my answer.
Excellent.
Oh, good one.
I love Roger Clark, and his social media is the best.
His social media is one of the funniest things, like, and I the best
can't
part
get
is
enough Roger Clark.
He doesn't know
no
that
idea.
He's funny.
Not a clue. No. It's the best. It's like that self-aware, I mean, it's like a Labrador. Like, you're just like, oh, heaven. Heaven.
No, and he doesn't have that. He's not embarrassed by anything.
So no. Nothing.
You want,
he's
Roger,
pure
Roger,
id. I adore him.
You go try this sport where you're hanging 100
like, before
feet.
You even finish the sentence, he's got the helmet on.
Yeah. All right, difficult people pairing number two.
Yes. Oh, Giuliani, no question. Yeah, he's difficult for me to even think about without getting like a cold sweat, like breaking a cold sweat about. Not a fan. And I do miss Bloomberg. I know that he made New York, just like a gated community for billionaires, which I'm not crazy about. But I really miss him speaking Spanish. Like, I know that it's
that Twitter feed still lives.
The Twitter feed lives, but like
it's not
that blizzard this year. Like, I can't tell you how bummed I was not to hear Señor Bloomerito. Like, I just loved his Spanish because he never even tried to not sound like Michael Bloomberg. Like, it was just it was the best.
All right, number three on our list is this. Alec Baldwin and Anna Wintour.
Alec Baldwin, I mean, he's the one who's gonna shout at you. She'll just freeze you out and walk right past you, like I would in a tourist asking directions, apparently. So cruel, but no, Alec Baldwin, remember when he called that photographer a fathead? He didn't say fathead, but he claimed that he did later. He used a not nice word for a man of a what is that called? A long life bachelor? Confirmed bachelor, yes.
Oh, look at that.
Yes, and then he was like, I didn't say that, I said fathead. And you're like, all right, Alec Baldwin.
Fathead.
Yeah.
Difficult people pairing number four. We have the Subway man spreader and the Showtime guys.
This is both a human nightmare. I mean, I'm gonna say the Showtime guys because they're taking up more space, but if the man spreader had like a really smelly lunch on his lap,
like a hot plate of Indian food.
Yeah, exactly. Then it would be the one on the left. Yeah.
Yeah. Showtime gets me.
I'm so worried about getting kicked in the face by those guys.
It's less about that and more that I would say one in 100 times that I'm on the subway, that I would actually be in the mood for. Showtime.
But wait, talk to me about that one out of 100 times. Like, what is that like when you're like, I'm bored. I wish I could have something to spice up my day. Like,
I just think most of the time, I think of myself as a relatively like pleasant person, but on the subway, I just feel, leave me alone.
I feel like when they first started it, some of them were pretty good. And now we're onto the C-list Showtime guys.
Yeah. They need to up their game a little bit.
Yeah. One more. Number five. Is it Billy or Julie?
Look at Billy all dolled up.
I know, he's a handsome guy. Well, it depends on the situation. I think we can both be difficult and we can also both be very delightful to work with in general. But like, I don't know. If it were a matter of like, you have to go to this party tonight, I would be the more difficult one. Like he'd be in his suit and, you know, ready to like go, and I would just be like, it's pajama time. So
I feel you on that. That's not that difficult. That's like.
But if somebody was trying to get me to come to something, then I would be I'd be challenging. No, we haven't like thrown any like straight up hissy fits on set, but maybe season three, God willing, we'll have. And somebody can tape it like Christian Bale. That would be amazing.
Are you the boss of everything on set?
Define the boss of everything.
I don't know. I think if you're the boss of everything, you know you're the boss of everything.
I'm not the director. The director keeps like things moving, and I would hate to be the director. Directing is so time consuming. It's so much. I don't understand how like Lena Dunham writes and stars and directs all of those episodes. It Mm-mm. boggles my mind. The energy alone. But am I? Yeah, I'm the boss. Yeah.
anything you can tell us about season two? Can you take the wraps off anything?
Yes. We have like it's so funny that you mentioned like how New York it is. Like there's so many tabloid soup. Like I would love to do a Zumba Madam episode. Like we have a Cannibal Cop reference. Like. We have
people are clapping for the Cannibal Cop.
Yeah, no, they're big fans of his work.
Oh my God!
Hang on, I thought he. It turned out he didn't do. He was just looking into it.
Just though.
Give me a break.
There's a lot contained in that.
Did you watch the documentary on him?
Yeah, watch the documentary and talk about whether or not.
I think he said he was
on OKCupid.
He was just checking it out. Just was.
Interactive than, I've perused sites myself. I don't get into, it's,
yeah.
He's,
okay. He made anyway. Some plans. He had some tools. There were things.
Yeah, there were things. There were measurements of the oven, and it's, yeah. You know.
I'm sorry, I took you off the topic there.
No, I could talk about Cannibal Cop
yeah,
for another
me too. Yeah, me too.
I would love nothing than to talk about Gilberto Valle, who I got a text from a girlfriend who was like,
don't. She saw him on a dating site.
No, he's following her on Twitter.
Oh. That's worse.
And so that naturally led me to just be like, here we go, Cannibal Cop's Twitter. What's on this feed? And right. And he was making
up to go look at
making
later.
Snacks for Super Bowl
Sunday. Stop it!
And so one of his tweets was just loaf of bread. I don't even know what that meant, but he was getting excited about like the food he was. I don't know. It's just.
How about how much food he was cooking in the documentary?
That disgusting omelet he was making, and the dog like waiting for the omelet to drop, and his mother being like, "My kid's a good boy." That documentary's a nightmare. I do not recommend anybody watch it. But yeah, there's a lot of New York stuff. There's stuff that comes from real life. I was scammed out of money for Hamilton tickets that I bought on Craigslist that turned out to be fake. So that happened, and I got a lot of satisfaction out of leaving more and more abusive texts to my scammer. And at one point, I may have or may not have lied about having a sister who had cancer and that this was her last wish, and he cheated her out of it. And I told that to the writer's room the next day, and they're like, all right, episode 6, we've got it. Let's do this.
Season 2 can be seen when?
July.
Julie Klausner, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Thanks, Pat.
Thank you. I would have never guessed the Cannibal Cop was on our list of topics tonight, Jenny.
My friend Aaron Lee Carr made that documentary.
Oh, that's how you know about the Cannibal yeah. Cop in detail.
It's a really good documentary. Thought crimes.
Shall we do trivia?
We should.
Okay, each time we do Pat and Jamie's New York, we have our trivia contest. Leslie, you selected players earlier, right?
Huh?
All right.
Oh, yeah, there they are.
There they are.
Trivia. It's Ari, Nisha.
Come on up here in front. Welcome. On the far side, we have?
Nisha,
hold the microphone close and tell us how you ended up here. Did you choose to come? Did you get dragged by somebody?
No, I chose to come.
Okay. What do you do when you're not here at 92nd Street Y?
I'm in school.
And you're studying general school stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Nisha, pass the microphone to your competitor. Your name is?
Ari.
Are you in school, Ari?
I work for a school, actually.
Oh, what do you do? Can you tell me what you do at the school?
I work for a dean at Yeshiva University.
Did you volunteer for trivia? Did you get recruited by Leslie?
I jumped up and down.
Excellent.
He was first hand up.
We have a category kind of on our theme for the last few minutes, the difficult people of New York City. I'm going to play World Series of Pop Culture Rules, which means that I ask a question of Nisha. If she can't answer it, you get a chance to steal it. Then I'll ask a question of you, and she gets a chance to steal if you don't get it correctly. I have 6 questions in total. First to 6 questions gets their choice of another event at 92nd Street Y or a membership to the fitness center here at the 92nd Street Y. We begin with Nisha. Nisha, our category, difficult people in New York City. First question, in 2012, a man was arrested in Central Park after going on a crazed, obscenity-filled rant while dressed as which lovable television character?
Can you repeat the question?
Sure. A man was arrested in Central Park in 2012. He had gone on a crazy, obscenity-filled rant while dressed as which lovable television character?
Elmo?
Elmo is correct. Did you have first-hand knowledge of that, or did you guess from lovable television character?
I guessed from lovable television characters.
Pass the microphone over to Ari. Ari, question 2 is for you. Which pro baseball player's 2000 rant in Sports Illustrated managed to offend not only Yankees and Mets fans, but nearly every ethnic, religious, and cultural group in New York City?
Oh, God. Baseball, is it?
Yeah. It was a pro baseball player. I'm trying to think if I can add a clue as good as lovable television character.
Yeah.
Which pro baseball player whose last name is shared with a chair went on a 2000 rant and managed to offend not only Mets and Yankees fans, but nearly every ethnic and religious group.
I hope you know this. I don't know anything about baseball. I'm being honest there.
Okay. Do you want to go with the last name is inspired by a chair part?
A chair.
It's a comfortable kind of chair.
Comfortable.
Remember, Nisha can steal. Don't give too much away. All right, time's up. Nisha, can you steal?
All I know, his last name is Chase, right?
No, it's not Chase.
Okay.
That was John Rocker. Oh. Yeah.
Rocking chair.
These are hard.
That was a hard question. All right. Nisha, here's your question. You're going to get 2-0 lead here. In 2005, which pop star was ordered to perform 5 days of community service, picking up trash on the Lower East Side after being arrested for cocaine possession and falsely reporting a burglary?
Lindsay Lohan?
That's an excellent answer, but it's not the one we were looking for.
That is a good answer.
Ari, for the steal?
What was it again, sir?
It was 2005, pop star ordered to perform 5 days of community service, picking up trash on the Lower East Side after being arrested for cocaine possession.
It's not Pat Kiernan.
That's my first answer. I feel like it's Ray something. Like a...
No. No, it's not.
I'm sorry. I'm doing really well here.
No guess?
A rhyme.
No.
No rhyme.
No rhymes. No rhymes available. Can you steal it?
I can't. She can. She can steal from me.
Okay. Yeah, well, sure.
This is up to you, this whole game.
I have no idea.
It was Boy George. I guess I could have said this Karma Chameleon singer or something. Okay. All right. Ari, you can tie it up with a correct answer here. 2005, which actor was arrested and made to perform a perp walk after striking a hotel concierge in the face with a telephone?
Oh, he was just on Alec Baldwin? Didn't he hit someone in the head with a phone?
It's not the one we were thinking of in 2005. There may well have been an Alec Baldwin.
Definitely.
Angry incident?
It's in 2005. No rhyming for this one.
No rhyming. I need an answer.
Oh, Nisha, really, you gotta pick up the slack here.
All right. Nisha, can you steal?
What was the question?
Like the SATs.
Which actor was arrested and made to perform a perp walk after striking a hotel like concierge?
I know. Ask me anything about.
Thank you, Julie.
I don't know.
They don't know.
It's Russell Crowe, for God's sake. Nisha's still up 1-0 in a battle of successful answers. I have two questions left. Nisha, here's yours. In 2003, where's Christine from the 92 Wife? I don't want to award the prizes, is that okay?
Yeah. Oh,
God. Oh, snap.
2003. You can win the whole thing with this, Nisha. The NYPD had to tranquilize and remove an alligator and what other wild animal from a Harlem high-rise apartment? I think Ari might know it.
I go. You sure? A tiger?
Tiger!
I got wildlife.
We're tied at one. We come down to the decisive final question. Ari, you get the first chance at it. Mayor Rudy Giuliani banned the ownership of which animal as a pet in New York City, famously ranting about them during a 1999 radio call-in show?
A ferret?
Ferret is correct! Come from behind victory. Ari, congratulations. Ari, you get first dibs. You want to come back to 92Y for another show, or would you like the gym membership here at 92Y?
Can I get tickets for the Jane show? What is
it? You don't have to pick the show right now.
Yeah, the show.
All right, you're in for show tickets. Nisha, we've got a membership for the 92Y gym for you. Thank you both for playing.
Thank you.
You can head backstage. Appreciate it. Thanks very much.
Thank you for playing. Getting a little nervous.
Was I too mean about the wrong answers?
No, they all knew. Everybody seemed to know. Now we get to answer some questions.
I think they were too young. I think the questions were
Next time we'll talk before and I'll get an age.
Questions
bracket.
Were 10 years older than, you know, I've been on the air for 20 years, so it's all just blurs together. Our final segment is Ask Pat and Jamie. We take audience questions. This is your moment to find out what really happens at New York One in the morning.
Yeah, we got some good questions.
So, while I do trivia, Jamie screens them and I have no control over which questions she asks.
That's right. I have some that I'll give you privately after. have you ever traveled to a place that Travel with Val has recommended? I'll tell you what.
What?
When I see some of her segments, I am like, how do I get to go on some of these things?
Yeah. Yeah, and she's done, I mean, hundreds of them
yes.
by now.
But you'll see her in some, like, exotic beach thing, and I'm like, you got a good gig.
Yeah, and here you are reporting on the BQE
yeah.
again. I must have been somewhere. But it's my travel's never so closely associated with her segment.
No.
All right, I'm going to go back and audit that. And see how many there were.
How many places have overlapped?
Yeah, like if did Travel with Val go to Disney World? She must have
I'm
at some
sure.
point. Okay, then I've been. Then I've
she's
been.
She's been
one.
At New York One. I'm sure for what?
No, she's been there as long as I have.
Yeah.
So yeah.
She's definitely been to Disney World.
Okay. Did you answer that?
No, I don't. I'll have to audit also.
Okay.
This is a fun one because I think you're going to make someone in the audience very happy, Pat. What has been your favorite movie or TV show that you appeared in? There is, I hope you say what I think you're gonna say.
Okay, there are two. There are two. Yeah, you know, I am gonna say that. I didn't need you to whisper that. I got what you were saying there. The Night at the Museum is still one of my favorite cameos.
Yeah.
Because they wrote a terrible line for the New York One anchor, mm-hmm. and I completely rewrote it. And they were shooting it in Vancouver, and so I sent them their version, then I sent them the Pat Kiernan version. Totally used mine. New Yorkers are waking up to dinosaur tracks on Central Park West. But...
What was there?
It was just some boring read. It was just, you know... I don't even remember. How could you remember? That's not the scene that's been played a billion times around the globe. The other one, Jamie, I was thinking of that would be a natural answer to that, whether he was in the room or not. Richie, Jordan Roth's partner,
is
the man behind Nurse Jackie.
Right.
Richie, was it season 6, season 5? Season 5, they called and said, Pat, we want you to do a role for Nurse Jackie. And I'm like, okay, sure, tell me what my news anchor line is for that one. They're like, no, we want Pat Kiernan to be sick and come into the hospital.
Yeah. I will never forget the day you came in the makeup room, and that's our time to hang out at like 4 in the morning. And you come in and you're like, they asked me to be on Nurse Jackie. And I'm like, oh, that's so cool, you know? And you were like, yeah, but they want me to be naked.
Right, so the way they wanted me to act, and B, the initial script had me coming out of my street clothes into a hospital gown. And I'm like, does that need to be on camera? That couldn't be somewhere. Could there be another character cut away to while that's happening?
But the funny thing, I think I'm remembering this right, is that you thought that the bosses at New York One, who sort of have to sign off on things, were going to be like, no way. And they were like, yeah, go for it.
And I don't know what happened on the set, but they said that's not going to be necessary, Pat. It was cable, so, you know, on cable, you can do whatever you want.
So this is from Liz and Anne, who we met in the elevator coming up here. Hi, Liz and Anne.
Basically, Liz and Anne were in the elevator with the entire show. There was no reason to stay, because they...
They want to know if you actually read all the papers.
I do.
And I can confirm that, because there are certain times that I'll, like... I don't come by to like talk or gossip because like he's
in the commercial breaks at around 7:25. Dude, do not interrupt me.
Yeah.
There's a lot of pages to read still.
Yeah.
I know, I stay away for that time.
8 o'clock, you're welcome to come down, though.
I know, that's why I come and I hang out then.
I feel like it's so personal that I can't tell those stories unless I've read them myself, and that they're my favorite stories from the paper.
Well, it's a hard segment to fake.
Yeah. No, the producers have more of a hand in the rest of the hour, but that's mine.
So one last question, and this will lead us into the end. What is your favorite thing to do on your day off? It says in parentheses, in New York City. So I think a lot of times I'm sleeping a little bit, trying to catch up on some of that. But I'm off the rest of this week, actually. And I'm going to see American Idol.
Yeah.
And I feel like I had to tell
you. Well, that's not in New York City.
No, it's not.
Yeah, you and I have had conversations about American Idol every Wednesday morning or Thursday morning, depending on what it's on, for years. And I'm not sure what we're going to do now.
I know. We were like sort of the last ones to still be watching it, I think.
I guess it's time for it to go. But Jamie had said, I want to go see American Idol in person before it's over. And then you realize not only is it ending this year, but they've shortened the season this year.
Yeah, so it's over at the beginning of April.
So you're not showing up for work tomorrow?
No, I am not. Huh. It's late anyway. It's like... So I usually...
It's not the same when you're not there, Jamie.
Well,
I got to be careful when I say that because there's fine staff that fill in. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I miss you.
That's so nice. Thank you. I actually can't wait for you to go on vacation. So we normally end the show by saying, you know, catch us tomorrow morning, but I will be back on Monday if I don't stay in LA and, like, you know, all that stuff.
You can catch me tomorrow morning. just not Jamie.
And we put this show up video-wise online. I mean, you guys have seen it already, but... We put it up as a podcast. And
listen
to
it in your car as many times as you want.
And then we do more podcasts along the way, so you can catch up with us all sorts of ways. But you should follow our guests on social media. They are a hoot to follow.
Yes. Hashtag for this show, if you're tweeting afterwards, Pat and Jamie, when we leave the stage, we're going to come down and say hello to some of you. We appreciate you watching. We appreciate the people at 92Y for putting this together for us. We appreciate our music director, Leslie Goshko. Jamie, have fun with American Idol. Thanks for coming, everybody.
Thank you.
That was Pat and Jamie's New York. That was Pat and Jamie's New York. Yeah, there.